Ghazi, and since 2008, he's a professor of theoretical elementary particle physics at Technical University of Munich. So today, Alejandro is going to talk about the quest for the dark matter particle.
Thank you, Rogerio, for the introduction. Thank you for coming, especially to the students. I mean, this talk is meant for the students. It's going to be an introduction to dark matter phenomenology. So some of the senior members of the audience, especially the participants of the workshop, might find it too basic or maybe even too boring. But especially for the students, please interrupt and ask as many questions as you want, either during the talk or after the talk. Okay, so this talk is about dark matter. So maybe it's a good start to say what is dark matter. So dark matter is a likely solution to various puzzles in astronomy that have been with us for a long, long time. And this plot is one of the earliest manifestations or observations indicating the existence of dark matter in our universe. So here in the vertical axis, you can see velocity in units of kilometers per seconds. Here in the horizontal axis, you have distance in units of megaparsec. And here you can see that parsec and seconds are written with K. And this is because this is a plot taken from a paper from 1933, so we are talking about 86 years ago, written by Fritz Zwicky, with this title that it says that, okay, it is about the redshift from the extragalactic nebula. So here we're talking about times when it was not even clear whether nebula were objects in our own galaxy or they were extragalactic objects. So anyway, so what he did was to take observations of the galaxies in the compact cluster. Today is we know it is a cluster of galaxies. So he took the different nebula in this system. He determined the velocity of these objects on the redshift, and then he plotted the velocity as a function of the distance of this nebula to the center. Okay. And he obtained these different data points. So at this moment, it was just an observation. So he was not really appreciating the importance of this observation. So this happened a few years later, in 1937, when he wrote this seminal paper, very important paper, with title on the mass of nebulae and of classes of nebulae. And then what he did was a simple exercise that all of you could try to do yourselves. So what he did was to apply the Virial theorem to this system of galaxies. So you know that the Virial theorem states that two times the kinetic energy plus the potential energy is equal to zero for a self-gravitating system which is virialized. So for the kinetic energy, it's one half of the mass multiplied by the average of the velocity squared of the particles in the gas. And then for the potential energy, he assumed the spherical symmetry, and then the potential energy will be equal to Newton's constant times the mass squared, divided by the size of the cluster, multiplied by some parameter that depends on the morphology of the system, which is 3 over 5 for a spherical system. And then by applying the Virial theorem, he could calculate the mass of the compact cluster. You see, it depends on the size that you could measure with your telescope, depends on Newton's constant, which is known, depends on this numerical parameter, 5 over 3, and depends on the average velocities of the members of the compact cluster that he determined with his observations. And then what he determined was that the mass of the compact cluster should be larger than 9 times 10 to the 46 grams. Then what he did was to count the number of galaxies. He counted about 1,000, and then he calculated the average mass of each of these galaxies. So it is this number divided by 1,000, then he obtained 4.5 times 10 to the 10 solar masses. And he found this number quite intriguing, unexpected, given the fact that the mass of one average galaxy is about 8.5 times 10 to the 7 solar masses. Okay? So what this means is that in the compact cluster, and if the galaxies of the compact cluster are normal galaxies, then there should be a mismatch of factor of 500 between the amount of luminous gas and the amount of gravitating mass. Okay? So this is the first place where it was manifest that in the coma cluster there is more mass than the mass in the form of suns, in the form of stars. So today is not a method that we use to determine the mass of a galaxy cluster. Instead, we use gravitational lensing. So here the idea is that one has a distant object, the galaxy. Here we have our telescopes. And then the assumption is that in between there is an object with a huge gravitational potential induced, in this case, by a galaxy cluster. Okay. So according to Einstein's theory of relativity, of general relativity, then the light of this distant object should be deflected by the gravitational potential of the galaxy cluster, and then this would produce lens images of this galaxy at different positions in the sky. Okay. So luckily, this configuration happens for certain objects, and one of them is this Kubra cluster, Abel 1689. So here you can see the different members of the galaxy cluster. And it turns out that behind this cluster there are some sources of light that get deflected, you can see these arches, by the effect of the gravitational potential of the global, of the galaxy cluster. Okay? And then you can, I mean, this is more complicated, but people have done the exercise of looking at the mass which is there in these galaxies, looking at the mass which is in the intergalactic gas here inside the galaxy, in between the galaxies. And then with that mass contained in the galaxies and the mass contained in the gas, it is impossible to reproduce these strong lensing images. And it is only possible to reproduce these images if, in addition to these two components of matter, one introduces a non-luminous matter component which is distributed in this way. So now with supercomputers, it has been possible to reconstruct the dark matter distribution in this galaxy cluster, which is necessary to reproduce these strongness images in combination with the gravitational potential induced by the galaxies and by the intergalactic gas. Yeah. And it turns out that the mass of the cluster in form of dark matter is about 80% of the total mass of the galaxy cluster. So you see that dark matter is not rare, but on the other hand, it is quite abundant, at least in galaxy clusters. Okay, so this is the evidence that we have at the moment from galaxy clusters. There is also evidence for dark matter in this case of galaxies. And one of the most solid evidences for dark matter from galaxies, I mean, there were earlier ones from the 1930s by John Babcock, but maybe the one that is maybe most relevant was this paper published by Rubin and Ford at the end of the 1960s.
So who was the one working?
yeah, you can tell which one did the calculations. And yeah, so basically, Ken Ford, he designed the spectrometer, and then Rubin, she used this spectrometer to measure the spectra of 67 ionized hydrogen regions in M31 in the Andromeda galaxies at different distances from the center of the Andromeda galaxy. And this is the result that she obtained. And in fact, the main purpose of this analysis was to study the rotation of the Andromeda galaxy. You see that still they are talking about nebula, they are still resisting to call them galaxies. And you can see here that these ionized regions, which are on this part of the galaxy, they are redshifted. And these regions here, they are blue-shifted. And this is a manifestation that Andromeda galaxy is rotating. So that was the whole point of their investigation. But then they found that this behavior or these velocities are totally anomalous if one uses Newton's theory of gravity and if one assumes that all the matter in the Andromeda galaxy is in the form of stars and in the form of gas. Okay. And the reason why these observations are quite puzzling is, again, it is like a high school exercise. One can calculate, one can calculate what should be the velocities, circular velocities of these objects should all the matter in M31 be here concentrated in the form of stars and form of gas. Okay. So the calculation is, I say, very simple. So you have to equate the centripetal force with the gravitational force. The gravitational force is the usual one given by Newton's theory of gravity. And for the centripetal force, is equal to the mass times acceleration, and acceleration is the velocity squared divided by the distance. And then from this calculation, one obtains that ionized hydrogen regions, which are very far away from the galactic center, for example, these ones, they should have velocities that fall with the inverse of the square root of the distance. But instead, you see that these velocities tend to a constant. So this is the expected behavior that at large distances, when all the mass is concentrated here in the disk and in the bulge, you expect these velocities to decrease with the inverse of the square root of the distance. But instead, what they observed is that these velocities stay more or less constant. And also in this paper, they were making an interpretation for these observations. They were conjecturing that in addition to the mass, which is here in the disk and in the bulge, you have this population of this substance that permeates M31 and that extends well beyond the optical disk. So in this case, the calculation must be revisited. So you see here that the mass is a number, so it is all the mass concentrated here in the center. But in the second calculation, you have a mass that depends on the distance to the center, this application of Gauss' law. And then if you require that these velocities must go to a constant, then automatically this implies that the mass enclosed in this sphere must grow with the distance to the center. And this is the result that they obtained in order to explain their observations. So the mass of M31, the whole system, should grow as the distance, more or less linearly with the distance. And then they went a little bit beyond, because if you assume that the distribution is roughly spherically symmetric, then you know that the mass is equal to the integral of the density over the volume. So for the spherically symmetric distribution, this is the expression you get. So the unit volume is r squared 4 pi times dr. And then from here you obtain that if the mass grows as a constant, grows as the distance, sorry, then the density must decrease as 1 over the distance squared. So from these observations, they obtained a lot of information. So what they obtained is that either Newton's gravity is wrong, or the Andromeda galaxy is permeated by a substance which is distributed with this distribution decreasing as 1 divided by the distance squared. And yeah, so at this stage, it was not clear whether this was a peculiarity of the Andromeda galaxy. So in subsequent years, they made observations from many, many more galaxies. In particular, here they had 21 spiral galaxies, and they observed exactly the same behavior. They were observing, first of all, that they were all rotating. And secondly, that their terminal velocities, they go to a constant, or they continue growing as far as they could have observations. Okay? And then they were making the strong statement that there is an inescapable conclusion that there is no luminous matter beyond the optical galaxy. Of course, this is assuming the validity of Newton's theory of gravity or general relativity. Okay. And also, I forgot to say that in order to explain these observations, it is necessary to introduce in the Andromeda galaxy again, approximately 80, 85, 70% of the mass of the galaxy in the form of dark matter. So it is roughly the same ratio between visible matter and dark matter as we found before in galaxy clusters. Okay, and finally, there is evidence for dark matter at the large scales, and this comes from observations of the cosmic microwave temperature and isotropies. So this is quite complicated physics, but here basically we have in the universe, we have gravitational potentials coming from density perturbations, and you have matter which is falling into this potential, And then at the same time, this gas or this plasma is being rarefied due to the photon pressure. So here you have a competition between gas which is falling due to the rational potential, and then the gas being rarefied due to the effect of the photon pressure. So this leads to oscillations, and then these oscillations in the plasma is what is imprinted in this power spectrum. And this is a complicated physics. What is important for us is that this potential well is induced by matter, and if all the matter is in the form of baryons, it is impossible to reproduce this pattern of acoustic peaks. So it is necessary again to introduce an additional matter component, dark matter, to produce a potential well which is deep enough to reproduce these observations. And here you can see what is the energy content of our universe, and what is important for the purpose of this talk is that in order to explain these observations, one has to introduce a component of dark matter which again amounts to 80% of the total matter of the universe. So again here we find this ratio of 80% dark matter, 20% baryons. So it is quite intriguing that this ratio stays over many, many decades of distance scales. Okay, so this is a summary of what I have been saying so far. So over the last 80-something years, it has been established that Newton's theory of gravity is not, well, I mean, either it is not correct, or there is something else permeating our universe. And all these different indications have appeared at different distance scales and with observations which are totally uncorrelated with each other. Okay. So there is evidence for dark matter at the scales of the whole universe. So we are talking about distance scales of 10 gigaparsec. There is evidence of dark matter at the scales of clusters of galaxies. We are talking about megaparsec. And there is evidence for dark matter at the scales of galaxies. And this evidence has appeared both for the largest galaxies, such as M87 with a size of several hundreds of kiloparsec, and also for dwarf galaxies with sizes of about 100 parsec. Okay. And it is quite intriguing that in all these, at least let's say from kiloparsec on, there seems to be always this fixed ratio in the cocktail of matter content of our universe of 5 parts of dark matter and 1 part of baryons. Okay. Okay, so now the question is, what do we know about dark matter? Okay. So we have been able to establish that it exists. So what do we know about this substance? Okay, so the first item is a bit controversial. It's actually subject of strong discussions nowadays. So it is maybe not made of compact objects. So one of the prime candidates for dark matter in 1960s, 70s, 80s was that there was like brown dwarfs, planets in our galaxy that were not visible because they are too faint. I mean, the Earth is not very bright. I mean, it's quite difficult to see it even from outside of the solar system. And it could happen that all this missing matter is just due to, as I said, from brown dwarfs or some planets or some other objects that come under the name of MACHO, Massive Compact Halo Objects. Okay. So in the vertical axis, you can see what is the maximally allowed fraction of dark matter in the form of MACHOs as a function of the MACHO mass. And then you see that here, this low mass part of the plot is excluded by micro-imaging observations, by the MACHO and by the EROS missions. And then very heavy MACHOs are ruled out from observations of white binaries. So these white binaries should not exist if the dark matter is in the form of MACHOs. And this plot has been with us for quite a long time. There was this window allowed between, let's say, 40 and 1,000 solar masses that has now, as I say, has gained a lot of interest in the last few years because LIGO, as you know, has observed gravitational waves. And one of the explanations is that these gravitational waves, they come from the coalescence of two dark matter primordial black holes with a mass in this window here. So in the last, say, 5 years or so, there has been a lot of activity trying to understand what happens in this allowed mass window where MACHOs could constitute all the matter of the universe. And in particular, there were some studies by Brandt in 2016 excluding this window due to the fact that in some ultra-faint dwarf galaxies, they are not being disrupted by these compact halo objects. And also in Eridanus 2, it was discovered a star cluster right at the center of Eridanus 2. And this star cluster, according to this person, should not exist if the dark matter is in the form of machos with these masses here. Okay. But this is quite interesting to see that even up to 20% of the dark matter of our universe, or our galaxy at least, could be in the form of machos without conflicting observations. So a couple of years ago, there was a different analysis by Tumalacárregui and Seljak using lensing images, or the non-observation of lensing images in distant supernovas. So again, if the universe is filled with these machos of primordial black holes, then the distant light of supernovas should be deflected by these machos forming lensing images. So they performed the search for these lensing images. They couldn't find significant number of lensing images, and this allowed them to establish this upper limit on the fraction of dark matter in the form of primordial black holes as a function of the primordial black hole mass. Okay. And again, they concluded that the events observed by LIGO, they could not be due to primordial black holes in the form of dark matter. And also they concluded that the whole mass window is excluded for dark matter being 100%, sorry, for primordial black holes being 100% of dark matter. So these are the conclusions that people have reached in recent years. Of course, not everybody agrees with these conclusions. So this is astrophysics. Sometimes astrophysics is, full of assumptions. And some of these conclusions can be relaxed depending on these assumptions. But anyways, what is clear for the purposes of this talk is that none of these limits will apply if the dark matter distribution is smooth, which is what corresponds if the matter is made up by particles. Okay. So if the dark matter is made up by particles, then there is not a constraint, but if the dark matter is made of primordial black holes or any other compact object, then you have to be careful about all these constraints, and also you have to be critical about all these assumptions. Okay, so this is the first item. I mean, it's a bit controversial whether it's made of compact objects or not, but for the moment, for us, let's assume it is a particle. And the second one, maybe more important for particle physicists, is to state that the matter particles are dark. Okay? So this means that the matter particles hardly interact with the visible matter. And the reason for this is a little bit involved. I mean, sometimes people say that if it is electrically charged, it will emit light. But that is not strictly correct, because if dark matter is positively charged, of course, it will not be free in the universe. It will form a bounded state with an electron and then forming an object which is chemically exactly the same as hydrogen. So here you have a very massive particle which is positively charged, forming a bounded state with an electron. It is a hydrogen atom, but much heavier. So for the case of the hydrogen atom, X is a proton, but here X can have a mass of 1 TeV, 100 GeV, whatever. And then these people, what they did was a very clever experiment. So you have this object in the universe, which is like hydrogen. So once in a while, this enormously heavy hydrogen atom will fall into the sea. They will fall into lakes. And they will form bounded states with another hydrogen atom, normal hydrogen atom, and with a normal oxygen atom, forming an exotic hydrogen, sorry, an exotic water molecule. So this molecule is, again, chemically exactly the same as water, but it is much heavier than water. So what he did was to go to lakes, was to go to rivers to take a sample of the water, and then separated the normal water from this exotic water using spectrometers. And in particular, Smith et al. They found that the abundance of this enormously heavy water should be smaller than 10 to the minus 27 compared to normal water if the mass is between 10 GeV and 100 GeV. And it's quite interesting because if dark matter is positively charged, then you expect an abundance in our universe, which is about 10 to the minus 7. Okay? So you see that this possibility is ruled out by many, many orders of magnitude. It could happen that the matter particle has negative charge. In this case, it will bind to nuclei. It will be like an electron, but much, much heavier than the electron. And then it will constitute anomalously heavy isotopes. And again, different authors, they have been looking for isotopes which are chemically similar to carbon 14, to oxygen 16, etc., but much, much heavier, and they have not found any element like this. And this, again, allows to exclude the possibility that their matter is negatively charged. Okay. So here we have been assuming that their matter has charge plus one or minus one, but in the last year there has been a renewed interest for merely charged dark matter particles. And with different observations, this is the mass range of the matter particles from 10 GeV to 10 to 4 GeV. And you see that the maximally allowed merely charge of these dark matter particles is something between 10 to minus 6 and 10 to minus 3, depending on the mass. Okay? So in this case, if the merely charge is 10 to minus 10, for example, then this is perfectly allowed by observations. Okay, and then the next thing that we know about dark matter is that it was slow at the time of the formation of the first structures. This is the result of simulations done by Simon White in the mid-1980s, assuming that dark matter was relativistic at the time of the formation of the first structures, or assuming that matter was non-relativistic at the time of the formation of the first structures. So even by eye, one can see clear differences between this universe and this universe. So in this universe, you have here these large structures here, which are not present in this universe. So even by eye and by comparing with observations, one could even tell the difference between this case and this case. And yeah, so these are the simulations, and this is the actual galaxy distribution that was observed with the CFA catalog. And then again, just by eye, one can see that our universe is much more similar to a universe with cold dark matter, with dark matter which is non-relativistic at the time of the formation of the first structures, rather than a universe containing relativistic dark matter. Okay. And of course, this has been confirmed by many more observations and by more sophisticated simulations. This one only contains 1,000 particles. Current simulations contain up to 10 to the 10 particles. Okay. And lastly, we know that dark matter exists today. Okay, this is obvious from the point of view of astronomy, but it's not so obvious from the point of view of the particle physics, because we don't know of so many particles which are stable in cosmological time scales. That's the proton, the electron, and the three neutrinos. I think here the assumption is that these particles, they were produced sometime here after inflation, and they have survived until today, which means that they have a lifetime of at least 10 to the 17 seconds. Okay. So this is the set of, some sample of the most important properties of dark matter particles. They have no energy charge or no color. They have low velocity at the time of structure formation, and they have a lifetime longer than the age of the universe. And what is interesting for particle physicists is to compare the list of properties with the known particles of the standard model. And it is easy to realize that there is no particle that satisfies all these three conditions at the same time. So the one that is closest are the neutrinos, okay? Because these particles are long-lived, and these particles are electrically neutral, but these particles, they had large velocities, they were relativistic at the time of structure formation. And it is for this reason that it is commonly stated, and it's, in my opinion, a correct statement, that the existence of dark matter, if interpreted as a particle, is an evidence for particle, for physics beyond the standard model. And this is the reason why particle physicists, including myself and some other people in this room, are interested in particle physics, are interested in dark matter, because that could be some connection with PSM physics. Otherwise, it would be just a problem for the astronomers. Okay, so the next question is, if it is a particle, a new particle, so what do we know about this new particle? So for those of you who are particle physicists, then when you want to know some property of one particle, then you go to the particle data group booklet. It's a book like this thick, containing information about all the particles which are known. For example, for the pion, here you have the mass, the lifetime, decay modes, the parity, spin, isospin, etc. And so far, there is no similar page in the PDG about dark matter. Okay. Because at the moment, we don't know whether matter particles have spin 0, spin 1/2, spin 1, or higher spin. We don't know what is the mass. Could be anything between 10 to minus 20 electron volts and the Planck scale. We don't know if it is absolutely stable or if it decays with a long lifetime. And if it decays, we don't know how does it decay. So if the 20th century was a century where dark matter was discovered and where it was speculated that dark matter would be made up of particles, then the 21st century, we hope that it will be the century where we can identify the properties of the matter particle, and maybe by the end of this century, we can have a page filled in the PDG booklet. Indeed, yes, it's a difficult problem. But also, you know very well that by the start of this century, there was no such a page for the Higgs boson. And now this page is almost full, which is quite an... I mean, once you discover it, then it is much easier to start establishing the properties and then to fill this PDG booklet. Okay, so this is not going to be easy, because compatible with all those properties, there are many candidates proposed by very clever people. And all these candidates are well motivated by different considerations. And then what is frustrating about this figure is that you see that these candidates, they have masses that span over many decades in order of magnitude. So here we have candidates very well motivated, like the action with a mass of microelectron volt. We have here the wind cylinders with a mass at the Gat scale, and there are even some other candidates which are much even lighter. And likewise for the cross sections, we have particles which are very, very well interacting, such as the gravitino with a cross section of 10 to minus 30 picobarn, or some other particles with cross sections of 10 to minus 5 picobarn. Okay. So of course, it is quite difficult to probe of these dark matter candidates in a single experiment. So what people do is to focus in one particular candidate, the one that you like best or the one that you have the better idea to probe, and then to try to find this candidate or to exclude it forever. So in the rest of my talk, I'm going to concentrate on WIMPs, which is, in my opinion, still one of the best motivated candidates. So of course, this is arguable. And the reason why I think it is well motivated is because it relies on very simple assumptions and also that it is potentially testable. Okay. So the reason why the WIMP is well motivated is because the abundance of WIMPs in our universe is determined by what is called the freeze-out mechanism. This already applies for this mechanism, I mean for this candidate, because we know that freeze-out happened already in the universe to set the abundance of the primordial elements. So it was basically the freeze-out of the neutron abundance. And also we know that the freeze-out was what determined the picture that we have from the cosmic microwave background radiation. It was the freeze-out of the recombination of electrons and the photons. Okay, so the assumptions that it is made for this mechanism is that dark matter particles are stable in cosmic time scales. And also one assumes that dark matter particles, at least in the simplest version, interact with two standard model particles via this effective interaction, which for the moment we can leave unspecified. Okay. And this effective interaction controls the annihilation of dark matter particles to put standard model particles, the production of dark matter particles via collisions of standard model particles, and controls the scattering of the matter particles with standard model particles. So now the probability of interaction is controlled by a quantity which is called the cross-section. This is basically the size of the target as seen by the projectile. This is like the classical cross-section. And you can imagine to have a small interaction rate. This means a small cross-section. This means that the target is small. And if the target is big, then you will have a large interaction rate. So you can visualize these interactions as targets with different size as seen by the projectiles. Okay. And here the main virtue of this freeze-out mechanism is that at high temperatures, so when the temperature was larger than the matter mass, of course the matter particles can always annihilate into lighter standard model particles, E plus E minus, for example. And then if you have very high energies, then these standard model particles could regenerate dark matter particles. In the same way that in a collider, for example, via collisions of two protons with a mass of 1 GeV each, you can produce particles with a mass of 120 GeV. Okay. So this means that at very high temperatures, this process of creation and destruction of matter particles, they were in equilibrium. But of course, we know that our universe is expanding and it is cooling down. And at low temperatures, then of course, the matter particles can still annihilate, but these standard model particles cannot regenerate dark matter particles via these collisions. They don't have enough energy to produce heavy dark matter particles. So at low temperatures, the population of dark matter particles can only decrease. And then what happens subsequently depends critically on whether the universe is static or if it is expanding. So of course, we know that it is expanding, but for the sake of the illustration, let me assume for a moment that the universe is static. So what would happen if you have a static universe, and initially you have a population in some volume consisting of six dark matter particles with a given cross section, which is here illustrated by the size of these balls and by some velocities. And then here the rule of the game is that whenever you have two dark matter particles, two of these balls colliding, then they will disappear from this box. And of course, since the temperature is very low, then these dark matter particles cannot reappear. So then, you see that these two dark matter particles, eventually they will collide. So here you have the cross-section given by this size of these spheres. And then when they collide, they will produce standard model particles and they will disappear. And it is clear that if you wait long enough, and this is actually quite fast for cosmical time scales, then at the end you will end up with a universe with very, very few dark matter particles. This is if our universe would be static, but now things are very different if our universe is expanding. Okay. Because now these dark matter particles, they have their proper motion, which is dictated by the arrows here, their velocities. But at the same time, the expansion of the universe tends to drift these dark matter particles away from each other. Okay. So you see that this dark matter particle is moving away from the others due to the expansion of the universe. These two are also moving away from each other, but also this proper velocity of each of them makes them get close to each other. So these two matter particles, they will annihilate. So of course, a fraction of those matter particles will annihilate. But due to the expansion of the universe, it will happen that some of the matter particles will never meet another matter particle and will not annihilate. So at the end, when you have an expanding universe, you will have a relic population of that matter particles. And this is when we say that this number density of the matter particle freezes out. And also you see that this mechanism is very simple because we only have two parameters, which is the velocities of these particles and then the sizes of these balls. Okay, so at the end, the abundance will depend only on the interaction cross-section and on the velocities. And it is quite easy to see how it will depend. So imagine, first of all, that you increase the annihilation cross-section. So this means that we are making these spheres to have a larger size. And clearly, it is going to be much easier for these particles to annihilate even in an expanding universe. So when you have a large transition cross-section, then you expect to have smaller relic abundance and vice versa. And the second quantity of relevance is the velocity. So now here we can put all these velocities to be very small or to be equal to zero. And then here, clearly, the expansion of the universe will win over the proper motion of the matter particles. And in this case, it will be much more difficult for these particles to annihilate. So when you have a small velocity, then you expect to have a larger relic abundance. So then with these heuristic arguments, then you expect that the fraction or the total energy of the universe in the form of dark matter will depend on the inverse of the cross-section times the velocity. These are the quantities that I mentioned earlier. And if one does the exact calculation, then one will find the prefactor with this minus 27 seconds to the minus 1. Somehow here the minus have disappeared, but this is quite important here. And yeah, so what one finds that one obtains the correct matter abundance if the cross-section is equal to 3 times 10 to minus 26 cubic centimeter per second. Yes, this is a, you make a calculation. Okay, it's basically because the rate of interaction will depend on this quantity. And at the end, the amount of the matter you have today will depend on the inverse of the rate of the interaction. I mean, this is a heuristic argument to show which are the parameters entering, and you see that these are the only two parameters entering, the only two free parameters entering. All the rest is determined by cosmical quantities, by the Planck constant, by the number of particles in the plasma, etc. Okay, so these are the only parameters which are free in this game. And they enter in this combination. So you see that with these assumptions, one obtains that the relic abundance only depends on one quantity. And in particular, you see that it does not depend on the matter mass. Okay? This is also quite interesting. Okay, so let's do some numerology. Because 10 to minus 26 centimeter cube per second, this number can be cast as 1 picobar multiplied by the speed of light. So 1 picobar is 10 to minus 36 square centimeter. And so what this means is that if at the time of freeze out, the matter particles were moving close to the speed of light, and this is fine. I mean, we see that they have to be non-relativistic at the time of freeze formation, but at freeze out, they can be quite fast. And in fact, the calculation tells us that it is quite fast, this speed. But yeah, but what we see is that if the strength of the interaction is comparable to the strength of the weak interactions, then these particles will have an abundance today which is comparable to the observed dark matter abundance. So now we can do some more numerology, because 1 picobar, a cross section, is equal to a coupling constant to a factor of 4 divided by the mass squared. This is just for dimensional reasons. And then one can reproduce this 1 picobar by putting here a coupling constant of interaction between the matter particle and standard model particles of 0.1 and the mass, which is about 100 GeV. So then here we have a quite an appealing picture that if the matter has a mass of about 100 GeV plus minus 1 or 2 orders of magnitude, and if it has a coupling constant, which is 0.1, again plus minus 1 order of magnitude, then this particle, according to this mechanism, will have an abundance today comparable to the matter abundance, okay? With very few assumptions. So this is one of the bonuses of this mechanism, which is quite predictive and tells you where to look for these candidates. And the second thing that makes these candidates interesting is that we are talking about weak interactions, small coupling constant, but they are not crazily small. And we are talking about energy scales, which are high energy scales, but they are not crazily large, nor crazily too small. Okay. And in fact, nowadays, there are many, many experiments which are probing physics or probing new physics at these energy scales, and that they could be sensitive to new physics with coupling constants and standard model of this strength. And yeah, so this is a subset of experiments. So here we have, for example, Lux and Xenon that are looking for scatterings of the matter particles with nuclei. This is a dedicated experiment. The second one is, CMS and Atlas, that they are looking for the production of the matter particles via collisions of partons, quarks, and gluons. And finally, we have different experiments that were designed for high-energy astrophysics, looking for high-energy gamma rays, antimatter, high-energy neutrinos, etc. These instruments are there, so why not using these instruments to search for the products of annihilations or the matter particles into standard model particles? Okay. So let me discuss very briefly what is the status of these searches. So for the dark matter searches, so here the idea is that the matter particles, they could annihilate in regions with the density of the matter particles, such as the galactic center, into electrons, positrons, protons, antiprotons, gamma rays, etc. Now, these particles, they will propagate through the galaxy in straight lines in the case of photons and neutrinos, and with complicated trajectories in the case of charged particles, positrons and antiprotons mostly. And here the idea is to try to search or to detect this process of annihilation over the expected astrophysical background. So again, here we have at least two first order approximation or little free parameters, the orbital mass and the cross section. So here we have a very concrete prediction for the energy spectrum for these gamma rays, electrons, etc. And also we have an expectation of what could be the intensity of those fluxes. So we don't know what is the mass, but for the thermal freeze-out mechanism, we expect the cross sections and the velocity to have this number. And this is the first milestone for experimental searches. So here the goal from experiments is to raise sensitivity to probe this class of dark matter candidates. Okay, so this is not easy, okay, because at the same time you have a background from astrophysics. So this is a map of the galaxy in gamma rays. So you see that here we have lots of gamma rays from point sources and from signal radiation, from image quantum scattering, etc. And this is the actual gamma ray emission that was measured by Fermi in the direction of the galactic center as a function of the energy. And this is the expectation of the gamma ray flux for the matter particle with mass of 500 GeV that annihilates into two big worlds, and assuming a cross section given by the thermal cross section. Okay? And this is very good news. Okay? This is very good news because it could have happened that this flux is here. It is three orders of magnitude larger than the observations. And then this whole paradigm will be ruled out, at least in the simplest version. Or it could have happened that this flux is here, like 10 orders of magnitude below, and then this model would have been untestable. But it turns out, I mean, this is a measurement, and this, as I say, it is what comes out from the calculation without any wishful thinking. It turns out that this flux manipulations is just 1 order of magnitude below the measured flux. So this means that you have to understand your background to the 10% level or 1% level in order to distinguish this signal. But it is not impossible to find this signal. And then, first of all, it will tell you that the matter particles, so the dark matter is a particle. And secondly, that our assumptions about thermal freeze-out were essentially correct. Okay. So here we still have the problem with the backgrounds. Again, this is astrophysics. These backgrounds are not very well understood, but here we have a hope to detect these annihilations. So now here one has to be clever, one has to try to find good target regions. So this is a subset of target regions. This is a map of the sky, assuming that you could remove completely the galactic foregrounds. Of course, here the brightest possible corresponds to the best target for detection. And the best target is the galactic center. It is the brightest spot, but of course here the background is also the largest. The second interesting target are the Milky Way satellites. These are these targets here, these bright spots here. Also, one can extend the search to the galactic halo in order to reduce the signal-to-background ratio. One can look at the exaggerated background, and you have different search strategies. And let me describe what is the status in the case of dwarf galaxies, which is at the moment the target that is giving the strongest limits and the most robust limits. So this is SEWE-1. This is one of the satellites of the Milky Way. Most of these objects here, these stars, are from our own galaxy. The stars of SEWE-1 are the ones here in the circle. So if you just remove the stars from our galaxy, then you end up with this. So this is SEWE-1. So it is about 1,000 stars. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this colloquium, some of these stars are moving much faster than they should. So according to Newton's theory of gravity, they should be bound to this galaxy if the only mass of the galaxy is in the form of stars. So one has to introduce an additional component of matter, dark matter, and in this case, it is 3,400 times more dark matter than visible matter. So this object is the most dark matter-dominated object known at the moment so far. And this makes this dwarf galaxy, SEWE-1, a prime target to detect dark matter annihilations. Okay? So this is what we like to see. We like to see a gamma ray blob in the direction of SEWE-1. But unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, this is what we see. Okay, so we see no significant excess of gamma rays in the direction of SEWE-1. This was taken by the MAGIC telescopes with 149 hours of observation time. And this allows to set upper limits on the cross section for different direction channels as a function of the mass. So you see that these limits are 10^-23 cubic centimeter per second, and they are a bit far away from this goal, which is 10^-26. So this means that if one wants to see gamma rays from 0-1, one has to take more observation time, or one has to look at other targets. So luckily, the Fermi telescope was observing 0-1 and some other candidates for annihilations over a long period of time. This is an instrument which is in space, so it is much easier than using ground-based telescopes. And these are the different limits that Fermi set on different annihilation channels. Of course, Fermi didn't observe anything. But what is remarkable is that Fermi reached the necessary sensitivity to observe a signal of annihilations if the matter was produced via thermal freeze-out, of course, with some extra assumptions. But now, for the first time, maybe we are talking about the last 5 years, there is a potential of discovering gamma rays from annihilations in some objects, in particular from dwarf galaxies. And this was not the case 10 years ago. But now, for the first time, in the last 5, 6, 7 years, we have the discovery potential there. So perhaps next year, there could be a signal discovered. This is not the only channel that has reached the sensitivity to observe the products of annihilation, also using positrons or using antiprotons. But yeah, but the punchline of this talk is that now we have a real possibility of observing signals of particle dark matter in the next few years. But of course, one has to be lucky. Okay, so let me also mention that there is a bright future for gamma researches. So, for example, here you have different instruments, just in operation. CTA will start construction in Chile next year, in the Canary Islands in 2022. Hawk is in operation. A Gamma 400, which is a gamma ray telescope in space, will be launched in the next decade. And maybe a couple of minutes to make some remarks about direct detection, which I also find very promising. So here the idea is that the Sun and the Earth are moving in this cloud of dark matter particles. So this means that from the point of view of the Earth, there is a wind of dark matter particles going through us with a velocity of 200 km per second. And then most of these particles will not interact with us, but once in a while, one dark matter particle could interact with a nucleus, and then this nucleus could recoil, producing vibrations, ionizations, or scintillation light. Of course, the dark matter particle is totally invisible, but you can detect this nuclear recoil. And again, here the rate of scattering depends on the dark matter mass and on the interaction cross-section with the protons and with the neutrons, that we don't know neither of them, plus some other uncertainties. But let's consider the simplest wind framework. So we have dark matter particles that interact with the quark via the weak interaction. That was the first idea that people had in the 1970s. So in this case, one can forecast a cross-section of 10^-40 square centimeters that is actually quite small. It is 15 orders of magnitude smaller than the proton-proton cross-section. It is 10 orders of magnitude smaller than the electron-proton cross-section. Okay. And this represents the major challenge for this strategy, because you have lots of nuclear recoils which are induced by proton-proton interactions or by electron-proton interactions. Okay, so you have a nuclear recoil, you have to be very, very careful and very sure that this nuclear recoil has been induced by interaction with one dark matter particle and not by one proton. So to this end, there is a very elaborated experimental strategy, taking experiments on the ground, using different detection technologies, etc. And the result of current experiments is this one. So these are from last year. This is an experiment at the moment, xenon quantum. And you see that for a mass of about 30, 40 GeV, the limit on the cross-section with protons is about 10^-46 square centimeters. And you see that it is many meters of magnitude below the cross-section, assuming that this matter particle interacts with the quarks via the Z boson. And again, I think that this is good news. Okay? Because it could have happened that the cross-section is here, and then again, it would have been impossible to detect matter particles with this way. But you see that it is possible now to explore this class of candidates. It has now ruled out. You can rule out models. That is maybe one of the main purposes of theoretical physics, to be able to rule out models. But also that you can probe many more interactions. So in particular, it would happen that avatar particles do not interact with the quarks at three levels with the Z boson, but instead interact at the one loop level. So we said at the beginning that matter particles in the freeze-out mechanism interact with the standard model particles via this contact interaction. Now you can take the standard model particles, you can close the loop, you can attach the Z boson, and then since it is basically this process with this one loop suppression factor, the cross-section is expected to be 10 to minus 45. And this is interesting because this is precisely the range of cross-sections which is being proved by current experiments. So it is quite amazing that current experiments are sensitive to quantum effects in the dark sector. Also now, we know for sure that there is a fifth force in nature. So the fifth force is induced by the Higgs boson. It could happen that the matter particles interact with the quarks not via the weak interaction, but via this Higgs boson force. And in this case, one can estimate that the cross-section must be at most or about, or at, yeah, smaller than 10 to minus 45 square centimeters. That again is the ballpark of the values that can be tested by current experiments. So again, maybe this simplest scenario is ruled out by experiments. It was not like this 20 years ago, but now it is ruled out. But now current experiment can probe these two classes of scenarios. Okay? So again, it is possible, it is not guaranteed, but it is possible that in the next 3, 4, or 5 years we'll have signals from dark matter induced recoils. But again, one has to be lucky for this to happen. Okay, also to say that there is a bright future also in direct detection experiments. In fact, here you see that the progress is logarithmic. So these are the limits from 2012. So in 2012, the limits were at about 10 to minus 40. So it was the moment when it was ruled out these C-boson induced cross sections. And in the last decade, we have gone from a cross-section of 10 to minus 40 to a cross-section of 10 to minus 46. So we are talking about an improvement in sensitivity of 6 orders of magnitude in 7 years, which is quite amazing. And in the next few years, there will be further increases in the sensitivity by 1 or 2 orders of magnitude. Okay, I have some remarks about colliders, but here maybe I can skip it because you can ask me later if you want. Is that Brazil? Well, you should know. There is no collider in Brazil, I think, no, not yet. Okay, so maybe rather than conclusions, I have concluding remarks because this is an ongoing story. So let me finish my presentation showing again the first plot with Zbicki's observations of 1933 from the coma cluster. And it's incorrect statement that 86 years later, we still don't know why we have these velocities in the members of the coma cluster as a function of the distance. So what I have argued is that if dark matter is in the form of weak interacting massive particles, then we already had the chance, the enough sensitivity to see signals, but these chances are going to increase in the future. Okay? So you cannot go worse, you can only go better. Okay? And from the optimistic point of view, you could see signals in the next 3, 4, 5 years or in the next decade. Okay? But also it is important to keep in mind that dark matter could not be in the form of WIMPs. Okay, here we have many, many actions, many, many, many candidates. For example, the action is also a prime candidate. And also here is a lot of progress and a lot of optimism that if this is the right candidate, it could be detected in the next few years. Some candidates are more elusive, for example, gravitinos. And also, especially for the young people, it could happen that these observations are explained not by particles, but by new phenomena. Okay, maybe it is modification of gravity or modifications or some theory or I don't know what. If I knew, I would write a paper. But yeah, but one has to keep in mind that there could be some other solutions to these puzzles. But yeah, but for the time being, let me state that the quest for the matter particles continues. So thank you for your attention.
So we have time for questions.
Whoa, I don't know how to reach you.
I have a question for this prospective indirect detection experiments. Can you go back to the slide?
Yes, let me use the keyboard. The prospects, the just
for indirect.
Tell me when I want to stop.
Stop. One further.
This one.
Exactly. So are they complementary in the, I don't know, mass versus cross-section plane, or do they test the same areas? Do you have a nice plot with prospective limits?
There are gamma ray telescopes. I mean, Hawk is focusing mostly in the high energy gamma rays. Let's say mass light TV. Gamma 400 has a smaller effective area, so this is mostly optimized for 10 GeV, 100 GeV gamma rays. And the CTA, Ekenishin Cherenkov telescope, they will have instruments with different sizes, and they plan to cover everything between 5 GeV and 100 GeV. Now, an important complementary comes from the fact that Hawk is in Mexico. And I mean, for example, CTA next year will start the construction in Chile. So in Chile, they can see the Galactic Center. But in the Canary Islands, in the North CTA, they will not see the Galactic Center. Okay? So for example, some of these instruments, they will be able to observe the Galactic Center and some others will not. Also, a big limitation for these ground-based telescopes is that, I mean, especially for, because this one is fixed. But these ones, you have to be pointing your telescope in one direction, and that costs money and time. Okay? So for example, HESS has observed the Galactic Center for 250 hours, which is quite a lot of observation time for a ground-based telescope. But of course, they have to share the observation time with astrophysicists that they want to see a crab nebula or whatever, no? And yeah, most of these instruments, they will not spend their observation time looking at the dwarf galaxy, because dwarf galaxies are very boring. They don't emit gamma rays, they don't emit anything, I mean, unless you have annihilations, you have annihilations that is exciting, but it is quite difficult to convince the administrator of these telescopes to spend valuable time looking at some blank part of the sky. So in the MASG collaboration, they managed to do it for 149 hours, but that was quite special, yeah. So in this respect, these camera telescopes are much more advantageous. They're in space, and then they are looking at the space all the time, 24 hours. But yeah, but they have a smaller effective area.
But Fermi is still taking data, right?
Sorry? Fermi is still taking data for the next couple of years.
For how many years?
2 years, two more years.
2 more years.
Is there an upper limit on the mass of this fundamental particle?
An upper limit?
Yes.
Yeah, for the WIMPs, well, strictly no.
So if there's no upper limit, how can you distinguish it from a compact object? How can you rule out compact objects if there's no
upper limit? Let me see. Okay, about WIMPs, there is an upper limit of 100 TeV that comes from perturbative unitarity. But for machos, there is a limit coming from white binaries. Yeah, so, okay.
So what?
White binaries.
White binaries.
Yeah, so basically, I mean, you have a binary system. So a white binary system means that you have here one of the members of the binary system and the second one, which is very, very far away. So it is very loosely bound, this system. Okay. Now, if dark matter is made of particles, then the potential is basically constant, so there is no, let's say, this is not affected by this dark matter gravitational potential. But if dark matter if dark matter is made up of machos, you have this very heavy massive compact object.
Can't it be just dust? What's just dust?
If it is dust, I mean, lower limit or upper limit? Yeah, if it is lower limit, it's like dark matter particles.
Okay, so dust is allowed.
Dust is allowed, yeah. If it is very heavy, let me finish this.
But baryons. Baryons cannot be baryons because of nucleosynthesis bonds. So.
Why dust is allowed? Dust is barren.
Yeah, I mean, it is allowed for the galactic dark matter.
Ah.
For the galactic dark matter.
But not for the whole dark matter.
Galactic, exactly. I mean, for the full picture, it is not allowed, of course.
What if one is allergic to dust?
Yes, so just to finish this discussion, because maybe the students will be interested, yeah. If you have a white binary system and you have like a primordial black hole with a mass of, let's say, 100 solar masses, if this one goes very close to this system, then the gravitational attraction of this primordial black hole could distract the system. Okay. And that is what sets these limits on the abundance of heavy machos from the observation that these white binary systems, which are very loosely bound, exist in the galaxy.
But that's not elementary particle.
But if it is some smooth distribution, and you call it dust, galactic dark matter, or you call it dark matter particles, since there is no green dot potential, there is no force induced by these dark matter particles.
And this thing comes from Gaia. Gaia has some data on this.
Well, this is earlier. Now with Gaia, it's going to get better. It's going to get better, yes.
Questions? Yes.
I think last year there was a report about a galaxy without dark matter. It's right.
Could you repeat, sorry?
There was a report about a galaxy without dark matter.
Yeah.
And this week I read again that it was more galaxies, but the people were discussing about this. There is no agreement. I just want to know a status report or something.
Yes. Yes, these observations are very controversial, of course. And I think that even the experimental method has been rebuked by some other authors. But also the analysis of the data has been criticized by some people. So let me think what was the argument. Yeah, okay, basically they were observing ultra-faint galaxies, okay? So a very, very faint galaxies very far away from us, okay? And, okay.
What is the method they
use to... Yeah, I'm explaining data. Okay, when you have close objects, close galaxies, then there are two methods to determine the amount of dark matter. So one of them is by looking at globular clusters, okay? Because you cannot see the individual stars, but you have a global cluster, you have many, many stars together, so you have a bright enough object to be able to see how it is object moving in the galaxy. Okay? It's a dark matter tracer, okay? Because what we did before was for Andromeda, we were using hydrogen, ionized hydrogen regions. Those ones are very bright, so those ones are easy to spot. But when you have a distant galaxy, you don't have these ionized hydrogen regions. Okay? So you have to look, for example, in globular clusters, which are very bright. Okay? And the second one is, as I said, with the ionized hydrogen regions, and yes, and using these methods, both the hydrogen regions and the globular clusters, it was possible to establish that there is dark matter in nearby galaxies. Okay? Now, in ultra-faint galaxies, these are so far away, they could not use the method of the ionized hydrogen regions. Instead, they could only use the method of the galaxy, of the global clusters, which is subject to larger uncertainties.
So there's no agreement.
And in fact, there was one paper applying the same strategy that they were using for galaxies where we know for sure that there is dark matter. And using that method, in those galaxies, they found no dark matter. Okay, so if you are only using one of the methods that has large systematic uncertainties, that could lead you to the wrong conclusions. That is what they were doing. That they were using a method which is subject to large uncertainties, and they were drawing their wrong conclusions.
So you think that it's not right?
I'm not totally competent to say that, but what I have heard from competent people is that one should not trust it.
Could you share your opinion about the Malibra signal?
Do I have to?
You're being recorded. So.
Yes, okay, oof.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, I mean, Dama Libra, for those of you who don't know what is that, is an experiment that has reported an annual modulation of the scintillation rate in sodium ionized crystals. And they claim that they have that is the matter signal. I mean, what is clear is that they have this annual modulation. It is at 14 sigma, and that is unquestionable. Now, whether this is due to our matter, that is what, personally, I don't believe. And in fact, we have done many analyses about Dama playing with astrophysical uncertainties, and it was impossible to reconcile Dama with other experiments playing with astrophysical uncertainties, or even playing with the underlying operator, the underlying interaction between dark matter particles and nuclei. And we tried many, many things and nothing worked. So personally, I don't believe that the Dama signal is due to dark matter. But of course, I have the curiosity to know what is producing this modulation. So luckily, there are some other experiments that are trying to reproduce the Dama, because one of the things that are being criticized by Dama is their secretism. I mean, that they are not sharing their crystals with anybody else so that people could make some tests. And also the company that is manufacturing the crystals has a clause in the contract that they are not allowed to provide crystals to anybody else. But in the meantime, there have been some experiments using cesium ionite, which is the cousin of the sodium ionite, in Korea, and they have not found any modulation. And now currently there is an experiment called ANAIS, that is using sodium ionite, and that is trying to confirm that. Based on an experiment called COSINE, also in Korea, also using sodium ionite, and for the moment they have measured the rate, and then the rate that they constrain, they have not seen any signal, and the rate that they constrain is marginally compatible with the best fit regions from the Dama collaboration. They still don't have any modulation measurement because the experiment has been running only for 1 year, but in 2 or 3 years they will also measure the modulation. And then we will know, because if all these experiments see a modulation, it's going to be very interesting. And if those experiments don't see a modulation, then that will mean that the problem is in the Gran Sasso laboratory. And there have been some theories about what could be wrong in the Gran Sasso laboratory, connected to the rails, connected to the traffic, connected to many other things. But it's something that luckily we know, if not for sure, we'll have more information in 2 or 3 years from now.
Alexandre, I kind of a bit confused about the possibility for dust dark matter. In principle, if you would have some satellites observing kind of excess of baryons, because it would be baryon, there would be indication. we're really not sensitive now to understand whether it's can we exclude
sensitive to dust?
Yeah, can we exclude dust?
Well, actually, dust is quite difficult to detect. I mean, my neighbors are in Garching; they are working a lot on dust. And yeah, I mean, maybe the easiest thing to do would be to go to the space, to take a broom, to take the dust, and then to go to the laboratory and then to put it under the microscope to see what it is made of, no? And that is not possible. So they are trying to understand the composition of the dust and the properties of the gas, of the dust, using X-rays, using infrared light. Yeah. Even the distribution and the composition is not very well known of the dust. But what is for sure is that dust cannot account not even for the dark matter in our galaxy.
But it would be strongly interacting dark matter because it would be barren, and I would say, some spectral analysis.
Yeah. No. As far as I know, there is nothing, no experiment with dust, let's say locally. Let's say that somebody goes to the atmosphere, picks up the gas, the dust, and then analyzes that. Yeah.
Okay, so we can ask more questions to Alejandro during coffee. So there's coffee upstairs. You're welcome to have some refreshments. So let's thank Alejandro again.
Okay, so let's just get together just outside. We're going to take the picture of the event, please. Just outside. Okay? So it's 30 minutes of coffee break. Just outside the door.